we're here to think about stuff. And just to remind you, here are the questions that Julia and Karen have posed for us. So I don't know if we can solve tonight that great problem of contemporary life. And I don't know about George Carlin either. But I do want to take on the first two questions, which is the materiality of visual and digital cultures together with the coming apocalypse. And I think what's important is that we have to think these two together. Why? Because if we don't, we miss out on the ways in which stuff and materiality is now changing, and the global stakes of this as well. So to make this clear, consider these two sets of images, which I'll return to later. So the first is the material infrastructure of digital media. So here is a former nuclear bunker in the UK, which is now used for data storage. And here is a literal trash fire in Ghana with our high-tech waste. The second are colonizing utopias. So here you see Peter Thiel-inspired Lord of the Rings New Zealand next to new plans for floating island in the South Polynesian, in French Polynesia. Now, these images aren't surprising, right? So how else could we imagine that our computers worked? Right? How else except through these paranoid, energy-sucking, planet-destroying infrastructures, as well as these planet-destroying attempts to recycle the precious metals within our motherboards. In fact, what's surprising is that we ever thought these to be immaterial. So what's really surprising is that we were ever sold that we could go green by going digital. Right? If you really want to save the planet, print and delete it. Right? Stop hoarding your email and giving all your data to corporations which keep resuscitating your information over and over again. Right? And if you print and delete it, you're more likely actually to hold on to your data. So think about it, people. Let's think about the cloud, right? The cloud is supposed to be unstable. If humans are to survive, it's supposed to rain. Paper is far more stable. So why New Zealand and French Polynesia? Because they've now become the exit strategy for the valley's super rich. So along with Mars, these are their planned refuges. So folk like Peter Thiel, who, by the way, as I pointed out earlier, is obsessed with Lord of the Rings, are building bunkers and panic rooms in their isolated utopias in order to survive the coming apocalypse. This, too, is the stuff of digital culture. And stuff, appropriately enough, means equipment, store, stock. It was initially a body of soldiers, a garrison, reinforcements, armor, stores, military baggage. So hold on to this, because I want us to think through the internet from cyberspace to social media in terms of these geographies, as well as in terms of US urban segregation. Because segregation is the stuff that networks are made of. So part one, the internet was supposed to be a utopian trash fire. Okay, so the first two sections are long and the third section is really short. So if we're at the second section still and there only seems to be about 10 minutes left, don't freak out. So it seems pretty clear that the internet is a trash fire. We have angry, paranoia-inducing echo chambers, military-grade surveillance and clickbait, cyberbullies, and an infrastructure that's anything but neutral. And I love that Lisa Nakamura is actually teaching a course right now called The Internet is a Trash Fire. So every day, we're faced with new evidence of racist and discriminatory algorithms. So consider ProPublica and BuzzFeed articles from last year documenting Facebook and Google's inadvertent use of racist phrases to sell targeted ads. So Google suggested all sorts of racist advertising keywords to add to white people ruin. And Facebook enabled advertisers to reach people using anti-Semitic phrases drawn from the interests of users they determined to be like them. This, of course, was just two of many. Others include Beverly Skeggs and Simon Yule's work on how Facebook exploits the poor through predatory advertising, Sophia Noble's book on how searches on black women perpetuate porn and racism, and revelations that the software used by US courts to predict the risk of recidivism, and thus by some to actually determine sentencing and likelihood of parole, is biased against racial minorities. So these programs, as Kathy O'Neill has so pithily put it, have become or threatened to become weapons of mass destruction. Okay, but if this is so, what can we do? How can we make things right? Well, one thing you can apparently do is apologize. And there's Zuckerberg before the US Congress. But it's not just Zuckerberg who's saying sorry. New York Magazine recently published an article in which the internet itself apologized. That is, if you reduce the internet to tech execs, network architects, and visionaries, all of whom live very close to each other in this small, disaster-filled desert named the Valley, And here you see the mea culpas and explanations. And I'm not sure you can read this, but basically, it's the old guys in Silicon Valley blaming the new guys, the social media folk blaming the trolls, and execs blaming advertising models that foster click and bait. And here you see their diagnosis in 15 easy steps. And their diagnosis is basically naive libertarian hippies meet capitalists and screw the world. Now, clearly, things need to change. And there are real problems with the advertising model, regulation, and accountability. And as a Canadian, I'm all for saying sorry. For all of you who know Canadians, saying sorry is a bit of a national pastime. But we're really aggressive about it. It's like we say sorry the same way we play hockey. Sorry is good. But these 15 steps miss a lot of things, and they rewrite history. There's a difference between apologizing and becoming an apologist. And Lanier is always provocative and insightful, but exploiting users and their free labor in order to become rich isn't socialism. And it's telling that these folk, rather than all users, were designated as the internet. Tiziana Terranova, of course, has analyzed all this at least a decade ago in her really foundational concept of free labor. And these 15 steps profoundly misrepresent the past, because it's not as simple as utopia gone bad. Because first of all, the internet was always supposed to be a trash fire. So remember, in the mid-1990s, when the internet was cyberspace, Right? This is when we had blockbusters explaining to us that sending your credit card online was an invitation to murder. Mid-1990s was when the internet was also portrayed as a pornographic badlands. And in the mid-1990s, it was unclear that the internet would ever take off. It was unclear that it wouldn't die the way video phones did. So how many of you here are old enough to remember Clifford Stoll's prediction that the internet would never take off? And he predicted it would never take off because it's filled with trolls and harassment. Because there's no safe way to send your credit card online. These difficulties haven't gone away. So Stoll was right without being right. But it wasn't just Stoll. Many scholars pointed out the limits of cyberspace hype. And also, cyberspace, as the good internet, was literally dystopian science fiction. So remember Neuromancer? So William Gibson developed the term cyberspace in his 1984 cyberpunk novel, Neuromancer. And Neuromancer literally takes place after the apocalypse, after World War III, after global capital has destroyed and criminalized the working classes, after Japanese multinationals have taken over. Cyberspace literally was an apocalypse, a vision, a consensual hallucination. Now, what's key is that this dystopian future became utopian through a certain embrace of bodilessness. And here you see John Perry Barlow's infamous declaration of the independence of cyberspace that celebrated the internet as a space outside of sovereign states, even though the internet was, of course, built and owned by US states and corporations. And this declaration and the very notion of the Electronic Frontier Foundation relied on metaphors of US settler colonialism in order to make the internet new. Now, what's key is that this internet, this utopia, didn't come after business plans. This was the business plan. And so to make this point, let me show you this commercial that I try to show in every presentation.
People here communicate
mind to mind.
There is no race. There are no genders.
There is no age.
No age.
There are no infirmities.
There are only minds.
Only minds.
Utopia?
No.
No.
The internet.
Where minds, doors, and lives open up.
Is this a great time or what?
So this wasn't an anomaly. And in the mid to late 1990s, it seemed almost impossible to advertise the internet without featuring happy people of color declaring cyberspace as their escape. And tellingly, these commercials were actually pulled from the US market as soon as people started using the internet. Instead, you had to go to the Japanese market even to see these. And the same corporations that were putting on these commercials were also fostering roundtables about the digital divide. Right? And a certain paranoid logic drives these commercials. It relies on you seeing this and saying, of course, these people would be happy to be online. Right? So the message of this commercial isn't even the banal, don't discriminate, but get online if you want to avoid being discriminated against. Right? And the message is, if these people are online, so should I. Right? And the point of these commercials was to move the public debate away from was the internet really a pornographic badlands to whether or not it really was utopia. Now, all of this might seem hokey to us now, but it's still present. Right? So Snowden claimed that he leaked his data because of this internet, because he remembered the time when children could be taken as seriously as experts around the world. Right? This logic is still present in these dreams of utopia. In these dreams of escape, in these dreams of escaping from nation states, right, and colonizing other spaces in order to render them into utopia. And it's still there whenever the valley imagines itself as victims or rebels. And here you see Jerome Lanier's really on-point critique of this. Now, what's different, of course, is that Teal's dream is enclosed. Barlow's call was open, right? This is gated. This is gated communities on steroids. And this is crucial because this type of segregation is key to maintaining a sense of rebellion. And this logic, this dream, lives on whenever AI, et cetera, is embraced as a way to get rid of human bias. We have to remember that a lot of these programs were sold as a way to solve the problem of human bias, right? So Facebook fired its human editors because it was accused of being biased against conservative news. So machines, it's assumed, can't see difference and thus can't be biased. Although more cynically, it's probably that they can't yet speak to reporters off the record. Right? Compass was sold as solving the problem of individual bias. Right? So apparently a judge's sentencing varies with their circadian rhythms. Right? So if you go right before lunch and the judge is hungry, you're far more likely to get a harsh sentence than if you come up later in the dock in the afternoon. Right? So the idea was to counter these individual biases, but unfortunately they did so by inserting systemic bias. And these programs claim not to use race explicitly. It's argued they don't see race as a factor, so therefore they can't be biased. However, as Kate Crawford and others have shown, the problem is that race, gender, and other protected categories are present even when they're not. So even programs that don't explicitly use these categories still effectively do through proxies such as zip codes and neighborhood predictors. As the ProRepublica article revealed, factors that weigh into your risk assessment are proxies for race. So the proprietary Compass program, which has been unsuccessfully sued, asked people to fill out a questionnaire. And here you see how race is linked to the factors these surveys determined, such as man with no high school degree and single and don't have a job, line up with these protected categories. Now, in this questionnaire, Compass also asked people questions about their friends and families. So we don't know what's in the program, it's proprietary, but it's pretty clear that who you know and who you're assumed to know matters. But this isn't only true in the case of sentencing, but also in the likelihood of arrest. So consider Chicago Police's heat list. So to combat the growing homicide rate, the Chicago Police created a heat list of about 400 or so people most likely to kill or be killed. The police then visited the top 10 and told them that they should change their ways. Right. Now, to come up with this heat list, the Chicago Police didn't use overtly racial categories, and they didn't just study people's actual behavior, they studied their social networks, right? So they put people on the heat list not only because of their past behavior, but because of the actions and behavior of people they algorithmically determined to be their network neighbors. So basically, because of their friends, they became persons of interest. Right. So race didn't need to be an overt factor because it was already factored in through a long history of segregation and discrimination. And it was also factored in because network neighborhoods, as I will talk a little bit more about later, presume segregation. They cluster people according to their likes and dislikes. And this segregation matters, this resegregation matters, because networks create structures and consequences. So the heat list didn't just bring down the homicide rate. In fact, it didn't bring down the homicide rate at all. But what it did lead to were people on the list becoming 2.88 times more likely to be arrested. And people argued that if they were pinpointed by the police, the heat list, they also became more likely to be murdered. Right? These were people with fairly clean records who suddenly had the police visit. Right? So one person said he feared for his life because his neighbors would think he was a snitch. Now, a lot of pushback and criticism has focused on the use of racial categories rather than racism, right? So the underlying belief among a lot of the critiques of these programs were if we just got rid of ways of tracking race, then racism would disappear. But this is clearly inadequate and part of the problem, right? So we have to take on the really hard problem, which is how do we address racism even in the face of the constant erasure of race? Well, to do this, we have to examine the fundamental assumptions baked within network science, because baked within networks, as they're currently configured, are profound assumptions of segregation, discrimination, and history. Profound assumptions that these apologies don't even come close to addressing. Which brings me to part two, our cybergenic moment. Now, to get us to start thinking about this, I'm going to start with that infamous Cambridge Analytica video.
Clearly, demographics and geographics and economics will influence your worldview. But equally important, or probably more important, are psychographics. That is an understanding of your personality, because it's personality that drives behavior, and behavior that obviously influences how you vote. So how is this possible? Well, at Cambridge, we've rolled out a long-form quantitative instrument to probe the underlying traits that inform personality. This is the cutting edge in experimental psychology, known as the OCEAN model. OCEAN being an acronym for openness, how open you are to new experiences. Conscientiousness, whether you prefer order and habits and planning in your life. Extroversion, how social you are. Agreeableness, whether you put other people's needs and society and community ahead of yourself. And finally, neuroticism, a measurement of how much you tend to worry. By having hundreds and hundreds of thousands of Americans undertake this survey, we were able to form a model to predict the personality of every single adult in the United States of America. So how does this impact marketing and communications in elections? For a primary, the Second Amendment might be a popular issue amongst the electorate. If you know the personality of the people you're targeting, you can nuance your messaging to resonate more effectively with those key audience groups. So, for a highly neurotic and conscientious audience, you're going to need a message that is rational and fear-based or emotionally based. In this case, the threat of a burglary and the insurance policy of a gun is very persuasive. Conversely, for a closed and agreeable audience, these are people who care about tradition and habits and family and community. This could be the grandfather who taught his son to shoot and the father who will in turn teach his son. Obviously, talking about these values is going to be much more effective in communicating your message.
Okay, so Cambridge Analytica claimed to know your personality even if you've never filled out their survey. And it's because they discovered proxies such as buying an American car or liking Lady Gaga or philosophy which revealed your personality, right? So how many of you like Lady Gaga? Apparently you're extroverts. Any of you like philosophy? Okay, you all are introverts, okay. And so you'll notice that although they claim not to use race, the face of conscientious neuroticism is a well-groomed white female. Now, according to Christopher Wiley, who was the Cambridge Analytica whistleblower, Steve Bannon was the only straight man he'd ever met who understood feminist intersectional politics, which is why we need to think race, class, gender, and sexuality together. And intersectionality theory came from women of color feminists such as Kimberlé Crenshaw. Bannon apparently sees culture as central to politics. He adheres to what's been called the Breitbart doctrine, which is that you have to change culture in order to change politics. And according to Wiley, Cambridge Analytica went one step further and argued that in order to change culture, you need to change people. People are the units of culture. Now, we need to take all of this with a huge grain of salt. Right? There's a lot that we don't know and that we can't definitively know about the impact of Cambridge Analytica. The problem is that there's way too many false positives, right? So we don't know how many people would have voted for Brexit or for Trump anyway. And blaming Cambridge Analytica for everything is a way of avoiding other issues. But what's crucial is that these ads, this campaign, they were conceived of as emotional, transformational experiences. The goal was, in technical terms, to get you to take the red pill, right? To click on one link and then go down the rabbit hole. So you go and visit a series of sites that say the same thing so that you return a different person. And now, although Cambridge Analytica claimed that individuals are the unit of culture, what they sought to do was to manipulate clusters. Right? So their goal was to put you into an echo chamber with people like you, with people with whom you shared a secret passion or transgression, with people you shared the same triggers, and then get each other to spam each other relentlessly. Right? So these ads, again, were meant to accentuate fear, angst, and humor, to put people in a highly affective condition, because when you're most agitated and affirmed, you act most predictably. Right? And again, these people were put into their network neighborhoods not based on the majority of their likes, but on their most intense or odd likes or dislikes. So based on how you most distinctly deviate from the norm like others, is how you were clustered. Right? And this is what they deemed as the most authentic, where authenticity means, again, being a rebel. Right. So here you see an example, Twitter's message to me. So Twitter thinks I'm really stupid. I have thousands of followers, but hundreds of tweets. And it presumes that if I'm silent, I'm hiding something. Right. So in order to be authentic, I have to reveal something slightly deviant about myself. And there's a ton more to say about this, but not enough time. So just very quickly, consider this study, which revealed how easy it is to find out a person's age and gender based on their publicly declared Facebook likes, right? So it's really easy to authenticate a user's race, gender, sexuality based on publicly available information. And in 2013, Facebook likes were public. They became private in part due to studies like this. And they came up with predictions not only for physical traits like race and gender, but also psychological traits. And this is because over 58,000 volunteers on Facebook filled out one of those crazy "Who are you?" questionnaires. Right? And if these categories look familiar and Kaczynski rings a bell, it's of course because he's been linked to Cambridge Analytica. Now, to produce these results, the researchers basically created a vast user-like matrix, which they then decomposed into the 100 most relevant components. And right now, what you're seeing are the most correlated IQs, correlated likes for IQ and sexuality. Right? Look at these closely. Now, what's key is that you matter, your actions matter, not in isolation, but in relation to others. Data is most valuable, most useful for prediction and identification only when it's authenticated with and against others deemed to be like you. Right? So Kaczynski used an initial training set of users and likes to come up with a weighted correlation matrix that was then used to predict the status of others. And this was much clearer in their 2015 article, where they lay out their method for matching personality types. So they use 90% of their data as a training set to build a linear regression model. They tested it against the remaining 10%, and they predicted your identity, your personality type, by weighing these manifest actions. Now, what's key is this clustering isn't innocent. It's used to create identities and borders. Right. So again, what's important isn't the majority of likes, but likes that divide. Right. So it's not that everybody who has a high IQ likes curly fries, right? But those who are deemed not to have a high IQ don't like curly fries. Right. So these are odd, specialized likes that cluster because they divide. These correlations, in other words, build walls. And these walls occur at many different levels because networks currently presume segregation. At the heart of social networks is the axiom that similarity breeds connection, that birds of a feather flock together, that like acts like like. Right? Homophily drives collaborative filtering. Homophily structures networks by creating clusters that make networks searchable and predictable. So Facebook, again, allowed ProPublica to target its ad by linking similar anti-Semitic clusters. Right? And this is key because every large cluster now is made up of smaller, angrier ones. Right? Everyone gets to be and must be a rebel. Right? And a really retrograde notion of identity politics drives homophily. And here you see one of the most respected definitions of homophily from a fantastic textbook by John Kleinberg and David Easley. And I have nothing but the deepest respect for their work. But think of all the assumptions embedded in this statement. Right? Think of everything you have to accept as natural in order for this to be true. Both in terms of what's immutable and mutable, but also what's being assumed about you and your relations. Now, not surprisingly, residential segregation is offered as evidence for homophily. So they argue that one of the most readily perceived effects of homophily is the formation of ethnically and racially homogeneous neighborhoods and cities. And to explain how segregation arises, they turn to Thomas Schelling's famous model of segregation, which allegedly shows how local homophily can drive global patterns of segregation. Okay, so the model's basically simple. There are X's and O's, right? And in this model, X's and O's differ according to what he calls an immutable category, such as race, ethnicity, or native language. And in this model, and this is crucial, each agent wants to have at least some other agents of its own types as neighbors. And they care whether at least they have a certain number, and they'll move if they don't. So at each stage, the unhappy agents move. Here you see the first move at t equals 3. And again, at t equals 3, agents are willing to be in the minority. But what happens is that integration is extremely hard to produce. And here you see what happens at t equals 4. Now, this allegedly proves that in a process not based on segregation, agents, after all, are willing to be in a minority, segregation is the most likely outcome. So the problem, according to Kleinberg and Easley, is that from a random start, it's really hard for the collection of agents to find integrated patterns. Maybe. But this model and this interpretation only works if we erase, in fact, if we unknow the entire US history of segregation. There is no random start, right? So think through all of the institutions, the training, the planning needed to make this true. Think of the history of state-sanctioned segregation in the US, institutional histories analyzed by folks such as Nightingale, who've looked at intellectuals as well as the real estate industry, or Grace Elizabeth Hale's analysis of how segregation sought to make race and space coincide. Also, the desire not to be a minority isn't innocent, right? So if you look at the history of US residential segregation, the desire not to be a minority, the desire to move when there are too many agents around you of a different type, actually defines white flight. So what they're describing is actually a reaction to and against desegregation, a reaction to and against the civil rights movement. So the problem is that homophily redefines hate as love, right? So what's the proof of love here? You flee when other people show up, right? And love as inherently love of the same, love as the desire to flee, justifies modern definitions of white supremacism, which claim not to hate others, but merely to love their own. But how do they show you they love each other? By fleeing or hating others, right? Now, the ties between homophily and US residential segregation and urban policy are actually really deep. So homophily was first coined in 1954 by sociologists Lazarsfeld and Merton. And in that same chapter, they also define the term heterophily, a term that's been completely erased. But what's also been erased, and this thing has been cited thousands upon thousands of times, what's also been completely erased is that they came up with the terms homophily and heterophily while studying two instances of US residential segregation. Hilltown, which was a biracial but not quite integrated housing project, and Crafttown, which was an all-white co-op. In particular, they came up with the term homophily to describe the relationship between white liberals and white illiberals living in Hilltown, right? So to prove the existence of value homophily, they focused solely on the responses of white residents. And you were determined to be a liberal if you said that you think that people should live in housing, there should be mixed housing, and you believe that people of different races get along. You were deemed to be illiberal if you said people shouldn't live together and they don't get along. And then from there, they said white liberals overselect white liberals, white illiberals overselect other illiberals. Now, in order to come up with this, they threw out the responses of all the black residents. They threw out all the responses of black residents, which means that the very notion of value homophily is itself reliant on racial segregation. Now, the impact of this study on US housing policy and network science is disturbing, right? So in 1948, there was 70% of US citizens supported public housing. This was the era of the greatest income compression. This was when public housing was nice, right? All these people suddenly moved into these facilities which had hot water, laundry facilities. And this was a time when, for the first time, black and white residents got equal housing for equal rent. And this equality soon dissolved, and the US instead implemented more measures to help white Americans buy houses and amplified measures to prevent black American home ownership. But it's important to remember that Lazarsfeld and Merton were good liberals. They were intellectuals writing at the end of the Holocaust. But they never analyzed why Crafttown, which was an FHA-insured co-op for shipyard workers, was all white. They never analyzed the possibility of ownership for black Americans and the impact of HOLC and FHA. And they also chose these housing projects because they were closed communities and spaces of experimentation. So not surprisingly, other studies of homophily have focused on closed spaces, such as high school, colleges. Facebook itself, of course, came from liberal arts colleges. So through homophily, we have the swarming of the segregated neighborhood. Okay, so very briefly, what to do? Well, what if we took seriously the question, who is your neighbor, right? This question, of course, has driven Judeo-Christian ethics and political theory, right? And homophily threatens to cut through the Gordian knot of who is your neighbor to make this ethical dilemma trivial by making your neighbor yourself. We have to realize, though, that we never have to accept segregation or discrimination. And although that this will take more than network algorithms, algorithms are a place to start. Right? So for one, what if we treated the results of these models, these discriminatory models, like global climate change models? Right? So think of what global climate change models seek to do. Right? They portray a future we don't want. We see the most likely next step, so we'll do something different. They use probability in order to open up possibility. So what if we analyze social networking models and their political consequences this way? Right? Not to determine whether or not they really did have the effect that they are alleged to have, but to ask, what factors have been put in place? What present are we living in that makes these futures plausible? So what if we treated these models and their racist results as pointing to underlying problems that we need to fight? So what if we use the gap between model prediction and reality as the grounds for political action, while at the same time realizing, and this is why global climate change models are so key, that what we need now aren't more models, what we need now are action, right? So what does constantly uncovering the obvious do, right? How can actually building these models become alibis? Now these actions and these imaginings can start with networks, can start with reworking these networks, right? So what different future could we even put in place by simply probing our habits and our defaults, by probing the literary and performative roots of authenticity? And importantly, Milton Friedman, the evil architect of neoliberalism, urged his followers not to focus on disruption or crisis. These happen all the time in a capitalist society, but rather habits. And he admonished his followers to seed new habits so that the improbable becomes probable. Right? Hey, if they can use Kimberlé Crenshaw, we can use Milton Friedman. Right? So what would happen if we took these correlations and turned them into correlations? What structures of communities, what unusual communities would arise? Okay, so what if we took seriously the fact that Wu-Tang Clan is one of the most correlated likes for male heterosexuality, right? What then could we do with this mix of Hong Kong martial arts cinema, Staten Island hip hop, and Jacques Cousteau, right? What would happen if we explored how we're all entangled, how our actions constantly affect each other, how every individual is collectively formed? What would happen if we weren't always shunted into homophilous echo chambers? So what else would emerge if these clusters explore difference rather than similarity? What if these lines weren't similarity, but opposites, right? This is how electricity works, right? How many of you people know folk who are heterosexual? Apparently, opposites can attract, right? But better yet, what if we actually built networks based on mutual indifference? So the only, the most successful sites in that biracial yet segregated housing project where both races came together were Bingo and the Sewing Club. Right? So what if we thought through those spaces, right? What else could emerge, right? That is, what if we took the Kambahi Collective's challenge to treat all people as levelly human, right? And this collective of Black women were one of the first to theorize what's become intersectionality, right? And it's from their embrace of identity that they call for a level humanity, for a recognition that belies pattern recognition. And Daphne Brooks, Kara Keeling, and Jackie Stewart have been key to a revival of their work. And if you haven't yet seen their fabulous mixtape performance, I highly recommend it. And data for Black Lives Matter has argued that in light of Cambridge Analytica, anonymized Facebook data should be made available. That data belongs to us. That the kinds of privacy Facebook has offered is woefully inadequate and damaging. And there's a long history in the US of defining privacy, who has the right to privacy, in racial terms. Now, this call raises all sorts of questions about the effects of an anonymization, but it also points to the fact that networks are fundamentally open. So what if? What if instead of retreating into bizarre notions of privacy that actually undermine our safety, we took the very open nature of networks and the collective threads of identity seriously? What if we came together and developed public rights? What if we, following Kara Keeling's call, took care of our bodies and identities, not because they're simply ours, but because they're not? But because, again, we expose and touch each other all the time. What if we used our data shadows to create public spaces in which we can be open and yet not attacked? Thank you.
Essentially, what I'm thinking is that most of the people who are talking about ideologically or conceptually the things that you're talking about don't know very much about the nitty-gritty of networks and what might be some simple or achievable goals for people who are maybe starting from scratch in terms of thinking about and really hands-on working with networks to start thinking about the problems you're talking about, if that makes sense.
So I came to this in a rather strange way. So as Karen mentioned, my background is in engineering, and I started off as a and more in the hardware world. Little respect for software. I think it comes across in my work. Oops, sorry. I'm not sure I was supposed to say that aloud. And part of what always shocked me, oh, is it possible, sorry, to get the display up again? So sorry. So what you'll see right now is my is a TCP dump. So you'll see all the packets. So right now, my computer is not doing anything. I'm not on a website. These are all the packets being sent to and sent by my computer. Right? And if you think of how your network operates, your network card operates, it downloads all traffic and then actively deletes what's not directly addressed to it. Right? And so for me, what's always been strange is the notion that somehow networks were personal. And if you think about it, you know, we have this really strange notion of our computers as monogamous, right? But technically, in the world of engineering, the only mode that has a technical name is promiscuous mode, right? And your card is in promiscuous mode when it lets your CPU know what it's doing. So when you can see all the packets that it's being that's being addressed, downloaded, and sent, right? Now, why is this hidden? Why is this hidden from users? And why are so many users paranoid by the fact that there is this sort of give and tell that has to take place in order for networks to operate? Right? So since they're open, for me, the question has always been less it's always been baffling to me that the internet was sold as this sort of empowering medium of personal freedom, right? Outside of this kind of give and take. And part of it is to say, okay, let's take this kind of exchange seriously, rather than putting it behind the screen and see what emerges. And there's been some fantastic collectives and artists that have been working on this. There's a great open hardware movement. There's also, what's that artist collective that did that great installation where they basically had like a man in the middle attack that they was on a briefcase and they went around a cafe and then they started both showing everybody what was on their screen and then showing everybody what was on each other's screen. So again, part of it is to take seriously this and also to say there's no reason why this gets stored and downloaded forever. Right? In the early networks, this stuff was discarded all the time. It's not the right to be forgotten. It's the right not to be stored in the first place. And we can only think through these things when we engage with these technologies and think through both their limitations and possibilities. So, what are you doing, child? It's always exciting. It's always something different each time.
Thanks so much for that mind-blowing presentation. Is there any hope or possibility in achieving legally, regulation-wise, politically, regulation of this kind of stuff, or are we beyond the possibility of that?
Well, the EU is always brought up as the example, right? So they now have a Data Protection Act that the kicker in this regulation is that companies can't automatically recycle your data, right? Because what's used and what's important is that recycling of your data. So you used a website once that's then used to link here, that's then used to link X, Y, and Z. So the Europeans definitely believe that this is possible. Right now, there's like huge chaos over what this means, but it has led to places like PayPal having to reveal everywhere it sells your data. So you can now go online and see where all your data is sold to. And if you're and Europe's done this really interesting thing where to be covered under European laws, it could be even a data bunker that's in Europe. So it's a spreading thing. So this is all actually being thought through right now outside of America, but is tentacling into America because it's unclear where your data actually lives.
Hi, thank you. Thank you very much for this beautiful presentation. I have two questions that are kind of connected. First one has to do with specifically the real existing internet. I am, in a way, the most effective movement coming out of it is the alt-right somehow, I feel. And so I would like to ask you a little bit about this, if you can say something, because it's beyond segregation, maybe. And the second question has to do with the history of these networks, computer networks, and especially the Soviet attempts at, or other attempts at creating something totally different that maybe doesn't store private, I mean, works on a different protocol. So that's basically my question.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, see, I wouldn't put the alt-right outside of this logic of segregation at all. And what I think, so do you know Florian Kramer's work? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he's done a great job in showing what's so important about the alt-right is to view themselves in the same way that the Silicon Valley people still view themselves as rebels even though they've won, right? Mm-hmm. Is to create a certain punk aesthetic of we're still rebels. Now, how does this work? You have to drill down to create these clusters, this echo chamber, in which people can convince each other, right, that they're rebels, they're incels, right? Or you can take incel as a way in, right? Incel is a perfect example as a way in, right? You create that cluster, right? And that is an echo chamber, right? Which then can then be its own thing, right? But then how do you take this one cluster, because the alt-right itself is huge, right? There's different parts of the alt-right. I mean, for God's sake, Tia Tequila is part of the alt-right, right? So there's that part, but then there's like the more, the munchies, the hardcore, Nick Land types, right? So how do you create this sort of larger group, right? You don't say, okay, yes, I'm an incel too. You make sure you have these clusters, right, which you then can group into this larger thing. So what's really struck me is that, you know, growing up in grad school, we were taught hegemony, right? That in order for a weaker group to come into power, right, you convince everybody to be like you, right? You create these circles, right? But right now, it seems that what's happening is you have the disintegration. You need this sort of disintegration in order to be linked together through these consolidating factors, right? In order to have this thing that we're going to now call the alt-right. Now, in terms of Soviet networks, I mean, those are really fascinating. And for a while, what's his face? Wolfgang Ernst? Mm-hmm. Was looking at Soviet computing, and they had this fascinating, as you must know, it was supposed to be dialectic. It wasn't, you know, binary is bad, so we had to have these dialectic non-functioning computers, right? But the open harbor people I'm most excited by are in the former Soviet Union right now.
Hi, excuse me, sorry. Thank you so much for your presentation, and I really liked your connection to the futurity of public space. But I just have a question regarding the construction of race and subjectivity, as well as its connection to infrastructure. Mm-hmm. You quoted Black Lives Matter and saying that one part of the one egalitarian move would be to give data to everybody. Mm-hmm. But I'm somewhat of the mind of the maxim that you can't vote out white supremacy and you can't uncode it. Mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering how you envision these public spaces, these more egalitarian public spaces, given that so much of the technological infrastructure of the internet is also owned by corporations and also has a stake in defining subjectivities and is involved in the construction of race?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a key question. And I think that part of what we have to do is work from within these structures in order to rework them. So part of the work that I'm doing now is to rethink some of the bases for this clustering, right? To say that we need to rethink the basis on which clustering happens and to think through different forms of ties. Now, this can't just be at a sort of theoretical software level. If we're serious about this, we need to think through these both the notions of regulation, but also the ways in which our hardware is really promiscuous and perverse. That right now it is also proprietary, but there are other things that are happening that we can intervene into. So I think that we need to throw everything at it, and I think we need to think as rigorously as possible about what is public, because if we don't do it, especially now, I quit my job at Brown to do this. and I think it's a really great opportunity for us to take on these hard things. There's no simple answer to that. I've written in the past about race and as technology, right? That if race has been used to categorize, then there might be something actually interesting about occupying that territory, right? So, and this is why a lot of this stuff doesn't work. When it says, let's get rid of proxies, let's just get rid of race as a proxy, right? Because then what else comes in place are more deadly proxies actually for race that aren't acknowledged, right? So let's start by thinking through that. And also what's the problem with homophily is that it not only erases racism, it erases community. It erases structures that make possible community by making it all individual agent-based, right? So I think that we need a broad coalition, and we need to work now. We need to work across barriers. And we have to ask each other those really hard questions that that one person can't answer.
Wendy, I was thinking about your kind of side comment that Facebook comes out of the liberal arts context. And I was thinking about how universities are implicated in this and whether you're thinking about that. And my question is partly coming from my position as a mom of two kids who are in college right now and seeing how algorithms are used in like college housing placements, and social media is used to create groups. And the observation of one of my daughters who's here at Penn, who chose it partly because of how diverse its population is, saying she's never had an experience of segregation in the way that she's experiencing now that she's living on a college campus, which was really disheartening to me. And you know, I think, you know, Penn is more diverse than it's ever been. But the separation in the social spheres is incredibly palpable, which I, you know, I'm now seeing through different eyes. And I'm wondering if you're thinking about colleges and the specificity of that as spaces that train the people who go out to, you know, run all these things.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So I'm also part of a Mellon initiative to rethink the liberal arts. And it's been interesting to think about that in relationship to social media. And what I love is like all these like, we can edit this, right? Sort of, you know, older, how can I, saying, you know, well, the problem with students now is social media, and like the, if we didn't have social media, then the liberal arts would be okay. And then me saying, excuse me, but Facebook came out of the liberal arts. Like literally the print Facebooks, right? As well as the notion of Facebooks and that creepy sense of community, right? Where you have the Facebook so you can allegedly know who people are even though you can't. And it's what's for me, what's so crucial about thinking through the liberal arts and its relationship to both studies of homophily and this kind of echo chamber relation is that part of the reason why they chose a housing project was they said was because it was a closed community that they could experiment on. They also likened it to they likened their work to work that had been done on the Japanese internment camps. And so there was a real, and then from the work on homophily went from these housing projects, and we have to think through, okay, why are people in public housing projects always the fodder of these algorithms, right, and used in this way? But secondly, it then moved to schools. And homophily was used in particularly middle schools and high schools in order to understand residual segregation in the South. Now, the ways they did that was by using the adolescent health database. But again, it was another closed community, right? So it moved from that and then to Facebook data itself, right, becoming the stuff of every sort of social media analysis, right? So now we can't get away from the network, the enclosed network. But I do think that the role that the, and you know, there's a reason why all tech companies called their workplaces campuses, right? In order to repeat this sort of enclosure. So I think at that level, it's absolutely key, but also to therefore use the promise, though, of the liberal arts as a space of integration, as a space of contact. But to do so, we have to do more than just rely on this quote-unquote space. So I think there's a project that can be opened up within the liberal arts, but only realizing the profound impact that it's had in producing these kind of enclosures as well.
Hey, thanks so much for your talk. I have maybe a simple question. I was just curious if, at the end of your project, if you had found any heterophilic digital spaces that you were inspired by that weren't just like newer versions of that MCI commercial.
Yeah, so, you know, for me, the heterophilic network is electricity. Like, it goes from negative to positive. It makes everything else possible. So for me, that's the heterophilic network I would go to. But for me, what I've become really disturbed by is, okay, they say, so Lazarsfeld and Merton say, there's homophily and there's heterophily, right? We're not gonna presume one exists over the other. But they only come up with a measure for homophily, right? And you can say, fine, it's because it's mathematically easier. You just select more of the quote unquote same. Okay, so what would a heterophily factor look like that? There. Well, you could say it's one minus homophily, right? Okay, but then the problem is what homophily has managed to do is make all those differences equal, right? So think about that for just one second. Like, by defining homophily first, and in that way, you link all differences together in this other thing that's to be defined against what the self is, right? So this is like Sarah Ahmed, cultural politics of emotion, right? The hate is used to define this other thing. So then we have to think rigorously about, okay, what would heterophily look like? So then the question would be, what opposites attract? And under what circumstances do opposites attract, right? And the most compelling example for me, again, is electricity, electrons, the way they operate. But you could say that there are other things as well. And the thing is, corporations really want to understand heterophily. Like, homophily is easy. It makes people buy the same. They're not happy about this. They, too, are looking for this other thing, spontaneity, randomness, et cetera, right? But for me, this is the question. Like, what if we moved away from either homophily or heterophily and really embraced mutual indifference or indifference? Like, what makes this classroom operate or this lecture hall operate except for the chairs we're all sitting in, right? Think of how a New York subway works, right? If you actually were intensely caring, liking, disliking, you'd never get on the thing. It wouldn't work, right? So for me, the kind of question that I'm trying to think through is actually the mutually indifferent. The thing that, like, if you think about a network with all those lines, think of the network as everything outside those lines, right? As making those lines possible.
Hi. So I have a what may be a kind of dumb question, but I'm curious because as I was listening to your talk, the ideas of homophily and how that's connected to branding, they just struck me as so deeply American, and all of your examples were also American. So I'm curious if this works in other national contexts. What does homophily look like outside of the United States, and are there elements that militiate against homophily because they don't sort of marry to the cultural context in the same way? Does that make sense as a question?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I think that, so I did a lot of this work while in Europe, and it's really interesting because when I was talking about this, I don't know how many of you know Hito Sterl. She was here recently. She's fantastic. So I was presenting with her, and she said, well, what if we just got rid of recommendation engines? Like, the idea that somehow things need to be personalized and pinpointed was one thing that was possible to militate against, right? Because it shouldn't also be the same. And in terms of branding and homophily, what's interesting, again, is that, okay, let's separate the two for a moment. So homophily is important in creating these clusters, which can then claim to be same but different, right? And a certain disintegration, right? So the question would be, in other societies that don't emphasize this, right, how does this play out, right? And one thing is, in Europe as well, they're very aware of the fact that whether or not they personally believe in these sort of clusterings, it happens to them whenever they use Google. It happens to them whenever they use Facebook. It happens to them whenever they use Amazon. And so in those contexts, the first thing they always say is, shouldn't this be regulated? So it's viewed as sort of an American problem that's been brought in, and can't we regulate the EU situation so it doesn't disintegrate to the same way? But having said that, there's certainly an understanding of homophily as well, and there's a deep sort of racism in a lot of European countries. So it's a question of how can we address these questions